Well, we are going to talk about internet censorship. So the main components of communication are usually who is talking to whom and what are they talking about. So usually the who portion is called the user, the whom portion is called the publisher, which provides some information to the user, and the what part is the information itself. So internet censorship comprises of a range of steps that the censor might take to either stop the publication of information on the publisher side or discourage access to that information over the link that connects the user to the publisher, or directly coerce users not to access that information. But the key point is to stop the information from being disseminated. I'll give you a very simple example of how censorship takes place, which would kind of gives us also an idea of what are the different mechanisms available. If YouTube.com has been blocked and I am a user, usually the set of steps that would take place is that I would type YouTube.com into my browser. Then behind the scene, my browser will generate a query to a DNS server. Okay, it was YouTube.com, but now it's ABC.com. So it will generate a DNS query to the local DNS server asking, what is the IP address to which I should map ABC.com? Now either the DNS server would already know the IP address corresponding to ABC.com, or it would ask other DNS servers recursively on the internet and somehow find the IP address corresponding to ABC.com. Once it has that IP address, it will return that IP address to the user. Then the user's browser will use that IP address to connect to abc.com, which is at 1.2.3.4, and send an HTTP GET request for some index page. And if it all works well, then abc.com would respond with the corresponding web page. Now, as you can see, this involves interaction between different entities. What a censor can do is that it can block the user's connection at this point. So when the user asks for the IP address corresponding to abc.com, the censor-controlled DNS server could either say that this domain does not exist, or it can say that, oh, the IP address corresponding to this domain name is 4.4.4.4, which is something which is under the control of the censor. This is called DNS redirection or DNS sinkholing. Then at the IP layer, say if it doesn't block the connection at this layer, then in the next step, what a censor can potentially do is that it can block users' attempt to connect to 1.2.3.4, which is called IP blocking. And then there is this concept of application layer blocking, which doesn't involve the domain name or the IP address, but rather a sophisticated censor might be able to look at the content that is traveling over this channel between the user and abc.com. And if it finds some offensive keywords, which are indicative that this connection is carrying some information which should be censored, then based on that keyword, it will send TCP, it can potentially send TCP reset packets to both sides, or do something else to just drop packets to just disrupt the communication.
Break the connection, okay. Do people get into trouble when they try and go to these sites, or does it, is that something that can be traced when, if?
Yes.
Yeah.
So when we talk about the human element of censorship resistance, this involves publishers of information and also the users of information. And that basically goes into the area of privacy and anonymity. So basically anonymity ensures that the users of a censorship resistant system may not be traceable. And what you just mentioned, it's called coercion of users or coercion of publishers. And ideally, one of the goals of comprehensive censorship resistant systems is to afford that kind of privacy to users, but usually they don't do that. And that's usually something that users have to take care of themselves by combining their use of censorship resistant systems with anonymity services like Tor.
I know that a long time ago, people would block out things in newspapers or block out things in images, and that would be a form of censorship. So how does it work then when people are censoring in these levels we've just talked about, and yet there's censorship-resistant software out there? What's going on? What will be the next thing?
I think it's like an arms race, right? Because the technology that is used to disseminate and retrieve information is constantly evolving. So now we have social media websites like Twitter, Facebook, which have loads and loads of user-generated content. So on the one end, it's very difficult for a censor to retain that control of information, because now there's this whole bulk of information to go through. And then also because this content is hosted by sites like Google or Twitter, so they can't just block the IP address of Twitter and block the IP address of Google, because that would incur a lot of collateral damage, the false positives that we previously talked about. But when the censor ups their game, then the censorship resistance systems also take the next step up. So there's basically a cat and mouse game which is in play here. The botnet can use its bots for distributed computing. For example, distributed password cracking, getting bots to solve CAPTCHAs.
Let's get the Google Glass in there. There it is. I think I'd be tempted to position it a bit further along the line here. It's not quite as immersive.